¿Se oye? ¿Se oye? ¿Se oye? ¿Se oye? Probando, uno, dos. ¿Se oye? ¿Megafonía? ¿Sí? Bueno. No hay diferencia, ninguna.
No, no, hay diferencia.
Bueno, ¿sí? Bueno. Pues muchas gracias a todos por venir. Es un orgullo poder presentar hoy al señor don Oliviero Toscani. Es una suerte que le tengamos hoy aquí en campus y creo que es una apuesta muy fuerte por los contenidos. Como podéis ver en Campus Party, pues hay una gran cantidad de actividades y también hay una apuesta por este tipo de contenidos. Habéis visto conferencias estos días siempre relacionadas con la tecnología, pero también tenemos un área de creatividad y en ese área de creatividad es en el que hemos decidido invitar a Oliviero Toscani. Oliviero Toscani, para los que no conozcáis su trabajo, ahora lo mostrará, pero simplemente quiero decir que es fotógrafo. Es un fotógrafo y un artista. Un artista generalmente que aparece en los medios por la controversia que se crea en torno a su trabajo. Quizás él no es una persona controvertida, pero su trabajo sí genera un gran debate en la sociedad. Y eso es precisamente el motivo de que le tengamos hoy aquí y lo que creo que le hace único y muy interesante. Y es que como artista tiene una visión muy particular y única del mundo en el que vive, de la sociedad en la que le ha tocado vivir. Y además de artista es un humanista. Entonces la suerte es que vamos a poder ver su punto de vista. Yo os invitaría a que no nos quedemos solo con la superficialidad que generalmente se ve en los medios de comunicación, que él sabe manejar muy bien, y no os quedéis solo con las frases que aparecen en los periódicos, con los grandes titulares, con la sensación de que es alguien que sabe utilizar las imágenes para simplemente generar ese debate. Ese debate lo crea con un sentido y su gran baza no es una ruptura estética, yo creo que no es rupturista, es una ruptura conceptual. Él busca como artista provocarnos continuamente para que reflexionemos y no demos por sentado muchas de las cosas que suceden en el día a día. En este caso, creo que viene a colación tenerle aquí porque la tecnología es ahora mismo Dios, es el paradigma en nuestra sociedad, es lo que de repente nos tiene a todos obnubilados y es muy bueno que haya alguien, por lo menos, y generalmente esa es la labor que tiene que hacer un artista, que venga a quizás recordarnos o a darnos un punto de vista diferente sobre todas estas cosas que ahora parece que se dan por sentadas y que nadie cuestiona. Entonces, bueno, sin más dilación, Oliviero Toscani.
So we speak English. Yes, I'm a photographer. That sounds stupid to say that, but probably photography has been the first profession that really used technology. Without technology, I couldn't be a photographer. So that's just to make you understand that even though at my age, normally people of my age, they are afraid of technology. I'm not afraid of technology. I think technology is a very important media. Every time has got its technology. And remember one simple thing, the technology you are using today that excites you so much in 5 years will be ridiculous. So you are working with ridiculous technology. That's the point that I think anybody that works and gets excited about this technology should think about. And why it will be ridiculous and obsolete? Because there is somebody who is thinking what is going to happen in the future. So, we are working with ridiculous technology. Personally, I think that all technology is always in the middle of the eyes. It's something that really stops my perfect technology that doesn't need technology. The perfect technology is that one. When you be able, with a blink, look at something and there the picture is made, transmitted, received, and used. We are still dependent of technology because we are not yet really civilized. Anyhow, before to talk about that, and I've been invited here to talk about creativity, and I think it's a good discussion because, you know, some people say I'm very creative, but what does it mean? I think it's ridiculous to say I'm a creative. Creativity is a consequence of a made world. I mean, not even God says I'm a creator. We say he's a creator. So, there is such a thing as a creative person. There is somebody who has got the courage to do something that one day, or even the day after, somebody will say, well, that is a creative work. Before to talk about creativity, of course, I'm going to show some of my work through the years. I went to an art school in Switzerland, the straight school that came from the Bauhaus. My color teacher was Johannes Itten, was the master of color at the Bauhaus. And of course, we were very much dependent of technology. I'm talking in the 60s, okay? Normal. And when I look back of the camera and the technology we use and we thought was the most incredible technology today, it is ridiculous. We were really good to work like that with that kind of technology. So, I finished school and immediately I started to photograph the expression of my generation. You know, I've got the same age as the Beatles, Rolling Stone, Dylan, and all that. So the 60s, concert, rock, miniskirt, not bad. We were much more interested in how the girl, the legs of the girl look, more than the technology. When we went to campus, the activity wasn't machinery, was more tactile. You know? That was the kind of technology we were looking after at that time. Anyhow, okay, through the years, you know, I'm working, I did work, and I still work for all the magazine, fashion magazine in the world. You know, this is Bellucci First Cover and Claudia Schiffer, Elle. Elle magazine is a magazine I've been working since always, since the 60s. I've done hundreds of covers, yeah, 1977. And of course, you got an idea, you want to do something, and you think, what kind of technology do I use to make that, to express what I think? It's not reverse. Here I got the technology, now I'm going to do something with what I know, with what is available. And so we go through L and editor, and of course, you know, we travel with pretty girls, good technology. We've been knowing a lot of good time. And of course, you sit in the studio and you study composition. That's a training that I still do today, that I have to do today. You know, sit there and do my still life. Be able to compose, to know what is the chromatic scale, what is the type, and no detail is small. You have to work with, when you do fashion photography, you got a team, you got the stylist, you got the editor, you got the graphic designer, you got your model, you got the makeup artist, you got the hairdresser, the hair, you know, that you have to direct. It's like making a movie. You know, and then you have to compose and decide where you go, how you photograph. And all that become before the practical production. And what kind of expression, what attitude, that all come from your mind and your heart. It's got nothing to do with technology. Emotion and surprise. And this is all, you know, decision that you do, you know, the new family, all the new woman. All the, what you see are reproduction from magazine or printed matter. I don't keep originals. I got no archive, I got nothing. I got just a magazine where my work has been published. For me, a picture, until it's not published, is not a picture. A movie, until it's not published, is not a movie. is an embryo, spermatozoa. Okay? To me, it has to go publicly, to the public. I don't take picture for myself. I don't need to take picture for myself. That's why I need a camera. I need technology to be able to show to other people what I think should be seen. Okay? So now, you see, they're all cover for reproduction from magazines. Different magazine in the world, different fashion picture. You know, I think, how do I go to La Scala? And there you dream, you make your own picture. Or, he's a singer. And then I like to go in the street, choose the people from the street, take them to the studio and use them as models. Or fantasize about the new ecological world. And you have to choose, you know, you have to find the thing, you have to put them together with your hand, like the old artigiani. And editorial work for dancing schools, for Liberation and campaign for Club Mediterranee, and Hermès and Valentino. I want 5 men dressed like that, 5 white flowers. The girl has to have that polka dot red dress. And then you have to make your picture. This is an old story, you know. I made a campaign for a friend who produced blue jeans, and they said, let's call him Jesus. And we published this picture, you know, little budget. And it was an incredible controversy in Italy, 1972. I think you were not even born. And the Vatican got upset, and the church and thing. And then one day, during the discussion, is that allowed? Is it good? Is it not good to make something like that? Pier Paolo Pasolini, I don't know if you know, I mean, he's a big Italian author, artist, writer, movie maker, intellectual, wrote an article on the front cover of the Corriere della Sera, said that the Jesus of the gene beated the Jesus of the Vatican. And he explained why. Anyhow, that was very interesting work. And prenatal, you know, all the, during the Serbian War. And then there's a book about a town in Italy that I did when I was still at Fabrica. And we went to this town and we got the people through the radio and the local TV. They all came to the studio. I had a big studio. And we went also outside to photograph them. This is like a family album of a town. And this is a work made for the German Green Cross about osteoporosis. I don't do exhibition unless they are practical exhibition to show something. I don't care about the virtuosity of photography. I think that when a picture is bad enough for not being used, normally turn into an art picture. You know, when a picture is bad, they use it, that's an art picture. That doesn't got no sense to put it on the wall. I don't think pictures should be put on the wall. That's not the task of photography. Photography is the modern art. Since there is photography, there is human history. Before photography, there wasn't a real document of the real history. Probably Napoleon wouldn't be a French hero if some photographer would have been there to show how many people he killed. And probably Jesus Christ wouldn't be so famous if a camera were there to see the miracles. And probably a lot of history would change if a camera would have been there. Just think the crusade, what we did to the Muslim world. How many did we kill them? None is documented. Since there is photography, we know the human drama. Okay, this is osteoporosis. Do you know what osteoporosis is? Your bone that gets crooked. Well, we don't need them, yeah. The bones get crooked when you will get old because you sit too long in front of a computer or a TV set. So that's how you're going to look like. Look. And this is the exhibition that is going around the world. I think it was also in Madrid. It was in Barcelona for sure. You know, they are from the front, the side, and the back of about 60 persons like that. See? This is a poster for a movie. These two. This is interesting. This is a cover of a book on the right side. This is a back cover. There is a village in Italy that on the 12th of August 1944 has been killed by the Nazis when they're retiring from Italy, going back to Germany. They pass by Sant'Anna di Stazzema and they kill 694 people of the village. Women, old men, children, wife, everybody who was there. And in 2003, the mayor called me up and said, Toscani, there isn't a document about that killing, about that tragedy. Can we do something? So I went to the village. I made this book, and it's called The Children, Los Niños Recuerden. I bambini ricordano. Why? Because I started to interview all the one who are still alive, that at that day they could witness what happened. This is Mario Olivi, 5-year-old. I did make a video. I got about 60-hour recording on what happened that day. And out of that, I made this book. She was 2-year-old, 11 and 10, and they tell, you know, he was saved because the whole family was killed and did fall on him. They came in with a machine gun and they started to kill anything. And here there are some sentences taken from the interview. So now there is a document, a human memory of what happened that day. That is what photography is for. When art, or let's say communication, do stop at form, aesthetic, composition, prettiness, is mediocrity. The only a unique task for art is and has to be the human condition. You say, well, you're so extreme. Just think of any big piece of art you know about. Think, from the Pietà of Michelangelo, that there isn't a worse condition than that. A mother with a dead son in the arm. What is worse? What could you choose more extreme? To the scream of Munch, to the Goya, the dark painting, incredible. That's the only task of art. All the rest is simple, mediocre masturbation. Okay, now this is an exhibition. This is a concentration camp, Italian concentration camp of the Second World War. And now it's a museum. And they wanted this work that I made in Sant'Anna di Stazzema. This is something else. 1972, a producer of sofa in Italy asked me to do a picture symbol for his sofa, B&B. It's called the Dolls. So I made this picture in 1972. Last year, the same company said, we are going to produce again this sofa in black, and we would like you to do the new picture, 30, how many years after? 38? And it's funny, you know, 30 years later, after this picture, it's quite famous because This is the first picture where fashion and design in Italy do cross. It's recognized for that. That was much before the Italian style, all that Italian made, all that Armani, Versace bullshit, all that, Dolce & Gabbana and all that. So I said, well, it's interesting to remake a picture of a picture you did 30 years before, 35 years before. So I said, what is going, for me, the modern woman? This woman is actually what women today would like to be. So you see, we are always too late. This is how a girl like, would like to look today. This was for me 35 years ago. And so I said, what is the girl of today that I think is the woman of today and the future? And that was my choice. It's quite an opportunity for a, let's say, an artist to work on the same subject with such a big span of time. So that's what happened. And now, of course, I do research. I did also a movie about anorexia, the influence of media, television, movie, advertising, and anorexia. I made a movie that was at the Locarno Film Festival, and it's going around a lot of university in the world. And then I made a poster during the week of fashion in Milan a couple of years ago. One poster in Milan, 80 posters in Milan, 80 posters in Rome, one double page in Repubblica, that's it. The minimum budget, the day after, the whole world was speaking about that. So you see, you don't need much, you need ideas. You need concept. And 1984, this is an example. I still do that, and I'm doing, it's called now the human race. I go around places, I put my white background, and I photograph people. This was a place in Paris. Look, Madonna was there. She was singing there. I got thousands of pictures made like that. Of people. I don't photograph landscape. I want the humanity. I want the people. I am interested in human being. And then I go in the street and I photograph groups. Or I go where, I don't go to the Seychelles to make fashion photography. I go to the garbage bin in Naples. And then portraits for GQ. And advertising for jeans. And Esprit, I took care of this company image for many years. You know, and I take my white background to the shop, and here are brother and sister, and they can do modeling, and mother and daughter, and girlfriend and boyfriend. And this is another training place in New York I did for years. At Maxis Kansas City was a bar near Union Square, where a lot of interesting people every night would go in New York. So in the corner of the bar I had my little studio, and I did photograph. I think I got about 32,000 people photographed there. So this is a little extra, you know, for about 4 years work, every night, from 12 o'clock to 4 o'clock in the morning, and then go to work at 9 in the studio. There wasn't any technology to waste time with, so I had to do this kind of thing. And this is Bertolucci and Scorsese and Jagger when we were young. And Lou Reed. That was also a record cover, right? And Warhol was a good friend as at the factory. So as you see, there is, I'm going through, you know, through the decades, and Federico Fellini and Deneuve, and then you go to Africa and make some reportage that's good for you to understand what's going on in the world. No technology there, just death. Carestia. And then new, this is last year, some new men fashion magazine from England, that's it. And this is from South Africa. I'm doing the work for Woolworth in South Africa. And then I've been doing this as a creative director of this magazine from Miramax. That was an interesting work I did for about 1 year in New York. Miramax is a production company who used to do this magazine. And of course you photo a lot of different people, like these are the porno divas. This is not a porno diva, but political. And this is a catalog for the Italian police, you know, the one guy in Naples against the drug. Look at the faces. And the special, and the catalog of lamps, Artemide, you see? So you see, I'm a photographer. I photograph anything that I would like to photograph, that I'm interested of. Is there such a thing as a war photographer, fashion photographer, still life photographer? I don't know, there is a photographer. And this is a campaign against the use of fur coat. This is for Prius. The nerds, the techno nerds from MIT, there they are, with the sandal and woolen socks. And this is the Amish, you know the Amish are against technology, totally. This is a campaign against the repression in Cuba. Do you know if you write something wrong against the regime, if you write against the regime in Cuba, you might end up to 20 years in prison. You cannot do criticism. So I made this exhibition for the European Parliament, where these are the faces of the people that now they are in jail because they did dare to criticize Fidel Castro. And you see the anger and a little threat, and you walk in and you see all those people. And this is a book that you give to your best friend for Christmas. This is probably the only thing that we do that we don't copy nobody, where we are really creative. And this doesn't belong to the book, but it could. This is for Stern, you know, Stern is a weekly magazine in Germany, 2 million copies a week. Well, no detail is small. And this is catalog of my glasses. These are my models, exclusivity for me. I can't pay him. He won't give me his address. I want to send him a check. And this is a hypermarket, what do you call, department store, you know, where you buy your food. That's it. Every week, a cover. That's it. And then I do the still life for the catalog. Oh, I like to do this kind of thing. Oh, this is interesting. A hardware software company asked me to do a work for them. So say, okay. So when I think of hardware and software, my first thinking is a donkey. I don't know why. There's nothing more hard-headed and soft-looking than a donkey. Probably anybody who is sitting in front of a computer looks like a donkey too. We all look like donkeys. So I don't know why, you know, but you can't, that's creativity. You don't know why. You are not secure what you think, and you just do it. Pushed by the drive of your instinct. That's important. Instinct is what has been pushing me to do what I did all my life. Inside instinct. And you have to learn how to listen to it and to believe in it and trust it. If you trust your instinct will help you. If you don't trust your instinct will fool you. But all kind of education tell you that you shouldn't trust your instinct because you're not sure. Instinct, something that you can't prove is right or wrong. But there isn't such a thing as creativity and safety. If you are secure when you do something, that means that you are not doing something creative. You cannot be secure and be creative. Probably the moment you are the most insecure in your life is when you are the most creative. But the world doesn't go like that. You push your thing and you know what is the answer. You want to be secure. That's the big problem. You cannot be creative with security. You don't have to be afraid to be afraid to be insecure. And here we go with high technology. Fantastic, huh? And they did appreciate, they made a big exhibition, you know, then I show you. I made them an exhibition, and this company go around, put their donkeys in the piazzas, Milano, you see? And in Oporto, no, Lisbon. No, there's something else. I take care of the image of Inter, you know Inter, right? Yeah, it did beat Barcelona, not Real Madrid. Anyhow, this one shot in San Siro, the owners, the team, all the other teams, the management, I think there are 600 people there photographed, plus 15,000 people in the back. One click, bang. This is a campaign that is out now in Italy for pet food, okay? Dog and cat, posters. And this is probably, you know, the difference. And the difference was like that at the time, and like that still today. And then I said, let's take away the product and just go for symbols. I could do that because what I was doing for this company made the company very rich. And the first thing an artist should do to achieve his freedom is to make his client rich. So if you want to be free when you work, you have to make your commitment rich. And rich doesn't mean just money, but mean could be rich in different things, you know, power, I don't know, rich. And Benetton was becoming very rich, well known all over the world, and I had the whole office, department of marketing, who did hate me, because I was doing exactly the opposite of what they were planning. I used to go to the meeting, marketing meeting, and say, okay, they say white, I'm going to do black. They say black, I'm going to do white. And that's what I did all the time. I learned from marketing what I don't have to do to be successful. So anytime you meet somebody from the marketing world, just tell them what you do as a job. He will be very embarrassed to explain you what he's doing. So I did all what wasn't in the marketing rules. I talked about pollution and the television pollution and the isolation and the isolation. It's the same as the one before. And differences at Mandela getting into power. And in the morning I was in court in London because I was accused of instigating violence because of this picture. And in the afternoon I would go to Amsterdam because I would get a prize for the best picture of the year. So that was is the European community. And, you know, a lot of, oh, mamma mia. It took me 1 year to find that angel. Look at the very well, that angel is so devilish. And brother and sisters. And First War, Gulf War. I made this picture. Big discussion, is that possible? Is that moral? Is that immoral? So I said, okay, I'm going to do a picture that can't be censored. No magazine wanted that at the beginning. You couldn't show what is the end result of a war. Everybody say, oh, so scandal thing. Now look at this picture now, so ridiculous. It's like the technology you're using today. Ridiculous in 5 years. Same thing. But you remember this picture, strange, huh? You don't remember a Volkswagen ad made 20 years ago. How come? So it did touch a humanity. It did touch a human condition. And I did stress even further. I took my baby somewhere where it's going on. Still going on. It's still going on. And we talk about that. Nothing changed. And AIDS. And the media that is quicker than justice. And how to be different between your peers. And immigration. And recycling by fat country to poor people and mafia. I could tell the story about all this. Anyhow, all this was made outlaw. And the police came, and it was a big thing. And the war in Yugoslavia. And then, it was so scandalous what I was doing that a lot of magazines wouldn't accept those pictures that you just saw. So I said, okay, I'm going to use that money, and I made a place called Fabrica. And I called Tadao Ando from Japan to make the place. It was his first work in Europe. Tadao Ando is a Japanese architect, good friend of mine, and he made Fabrica. And with Fabrica, we used to do exhibition around the world. This is in Holland, Bonnefante Museum. And we used to do a page every week in a weekly newspaper insert. You know, the view of Fabrica. This was during the football game in Rome. The World Championship in Rome. And every week we had our opinion, and then we did work for the Lawyers Committee for Human Rights in the United States, and evidence. And also, I finally could make a magazine that I always wanted to do, it's called Colors, a magazine about the rest of the world. I always wanted to do a magazine without news, and without celebrities. All magazine and newspaper, everything is about news and celebrity. And I say, we should do a magazine without that primary thing. So this is what? About religion, about the shopping, about war, shopping, fashion, travel, and genocide, about wealth for beginners, and monoculture, and touch, you know? And while you sleep, what happened in the world? Incredible, everything happened. And then I used to go to places where normally you don't go to make a catalog. And here we are, with voluntary people who go and take care of people in disarm. And became, or just in the street in China. Stop the people, dress them, pay them, photograph, and go. Everybody is a good model for me. Or in Corleone, everybody thinks Corleone is mafioso. No, look, these are the young people of Corleone. Or in Gaza, schools and street. Or you give the clothes to some Japanese young people in the street and they just do the styling. Or funny, you know, you think Jerusalem, they really all hate each other. I didn't believe. So we went down there and we found that people do like each other, even if one is Jewish and the other one is Palestinian. They made the baby the same day. So they became friends, family, and friend at the bar, a Jew and a Palestinian. And a group of music with four different religions. And friend in school, Barbara and Arab. Cut it through? No, just make it. Friend, they work at the railroad. Or reporter for two different newspapers. And here is probably my most important work. It took me 3 years. I wanted to leave Benetton. I had enough, you know, the company. I had to move, you know, I have to leave. I can't stay too long in the same place. I like to make things, but then when they start to get a system, I normally leave. But I wanted to do this work before I was leaving, about against death penalty. So it took me 3 years from when I thought to make the work until it was published. And the day it was published, I left Benetton. We on death row. And everyone is a long story. I could go on and tell you. Some of them has been executed. Some of them has been set free because they were innocent. And a lot of them, they're still there waiting every day to be killed. He, for example, has been set free because he was, even with such a assassin face, he's innocent. See? So. This is a big job, you know, to make, to go to death row is, there were 9 different states who still has got death penalty, and death penalty, where there is that penalty, it smells like death, is a mixture between medieval and future. And we cannot really say that America has got death penalty. There are states in the United States who never had death penalty. So it's not right to say America and therefore death penalty. No. Some states still have death penalty. And that's the only place where I was allowed to make such a job. To make a catalog, this is really the opposite of marketing. To make a catalog of clothes that you cannot buy and of people that you want to get rid of. This is really the example of don't trust marketing if you want to have success. And this is the symbol. And now this is an exhibition. There are 3 copies. One I gave it to Regione Toscana, who has been the first government in the world, in the history, that took away when it was a government, who abolished death penalty. And then another one is turning in the United States. A lot of universities got this work. And the other one is available for other requests. See? Oh. And this I show you quickly is what I'm doing now about human race. I go in the street, I got a portable studio, we put up our background and we photograph people. We got thousands of portraits. This is Israel. No, that was Israel. This is some French, Italian. Okay, now. I still got time. Who is here, the manager? You're not bored? There are a lot of people who are sleeping. It's good. Just go on. Now, I did make a little compito. Let's switch off the thing there. Or if you want, I can show you some picture like just like that. Okay? Just like that. Che va? Sì, togliamo lo schermo. No, I want to talk about creativity and communication. And probably you are interested because you are all attached to that problem. Vediamo lo schermo o no? Vediamo. Vediamo, eh sì. Quica. Ok? While I talk so you don't get bored, you're going to look at the picture. Oh. It's okay like that? Yeah. Okay, this is colors. It's too quick? Okay, this is fashion in color. Anyhow, let's read the translation. Creativity is a surplus of intelligence and sensitivity. It is the opportunity that potentially lies between our heart and our brain, and somewhere else sometimes, but mostly from between heart and brain, sometimes also a bit lower, but creativity is there. The human race is divided, unfortunately, in two classes, two categories. People who are creative, or they could be creative, and people who are not. I call them the human and the subhumans. Creativity is genesis, birth, divine force, energy, imagination, suffering, commitment, faith, generosity. Creativity has to be visionary, subversive, disturbing. It must be innovative. It must drive ideas and concepts. It has to question stereotypes and old models. Creativity requires energy and courage. There are few people left who have that energy. Because everything from education in the family to education in school and religious education tend to limit the creative energy that there is naturally in every one of us. All what you see there are issues of color that I did, okay? This was about religion. Truly creative people are rare. They are a tiny minority today because we all believe what we see on television, what we see on the screen, what we see in the monitor. We follow like goats. Bunch of goats. They follow the flock. They are a tiny minority oppressed by false proponents of creativity and by everyone else. Only truly creative people have no fear of creativity. Everyone else is afraid of creativity. The non-creative people oppose it and they curb it because they know that creativity gives rise to new ideas that sooner or later they have to come to to turn with them. The army of non-creative people is huge. It includes a mass of bureaucrats who claim that their position of power gives them the right to block creative processes. They exist to cut down to a level of mediocrity every idea that is not stupid enough to gain consensus. That's why all newspapers look alike, all automobiles look alike, television programs are interchangeable, different brands of clothing propose the identical style. Everybody is the same. The other day I was there making gas to my car, and there stopped one of those trucks full of cars. And I said, well, there are different brands. They all look alike. They all look alike. What's happening here? Where is the creative? What is? Marketing research. The economy is a pretext. Power of lack of culture and lack of courage to invest in ideas is a clear and undeniable sign of the agony of creativity. Paradoxically and ironically, creative people must constantly defend themselves from the bureaucrats of power, those who never need to defend their own lack of creativity and courage, but seem to identify solely with their role of accuser and censors. Everybody who's got an idea has got a problem. He will encounter a problem by somebody else. In the past, the success of great entrepreneurs, statesmen, and popes were always linked with the name of creative people. I mean, you all know who made the Cappella Sistina? Michelangelo, right? You all know that. But who was the pope? How many of you know which pope said, you paint for me the Cappella Sistina? Who knows from you? That's it. Those are our bureaucrats. Art is the highest expression of human communication. That's what art is. We communicate, and the highest and the best, the most qualitative expression is called art. And by art, I don't mean only painting and sculpture of the ancient and traditional art, but above all of them, mass art. Photography, design, fashion, architecture, cinematography, and so on. That is today modern art. Communication, like art, has always been at the service of one power or the other. There's always been a link between power and art. Power needs art to impose itself, and art needs power to express itself. There is a market there, and market is not just money. Market is where we meet, we show ourselves, we propose our product, where we talk, where we discuss. So we don't have to be afraid of market. But it does it exists a huge problem for anyone who believes that feel passionately about freedom of creativity in communication and the power that needs communication. The businesses, the faceless corporation, with their manager, to whom the risk of creativity evokes unpleasant reminders of youthful defeats and deluded aspirations. You know, you see those managers, that they would have liked, oh, it's gone. Where were we? They would have liked to become artists, you know, those managers of big company, and they are so envy and angry with you because you are creative, they are not. Where were we? I don't know. Did we see this? Wedding? A wedding? Let's go, a wedding. Matrimonio, donde sta? Yeah? Well, let's start with the animal again. Okay. It might be good for you that you see a thing twice. Creativity is communication. Today, the creativity of communication is conditioned by an obsessive search of consensus. We all want to do things that everybody has to accept. The research so the thing has to be accepted. That's the biggest mistake. In the false belief that consensus is success, fear of failure always produces mediocrity, because the chosen solution will be always the least risky and the most banal. in most cases doesn't even attempt to be original, but wants rather to be a mediocre and repetitious replica of it. That's what we are doing all the time. We do something that we think that will work. And that's the most boring thing to do. Modern creativity has been stripped from ideas and individual passion. It has been relegated to the role of a company servant. It has to be a vehicle for strategies that focus solely on rising the market price and the company stock. But the raw material of art are the artist, the communicators, the photographer, the designer, the writer, the author, the musician, the actor, the image creator. Good sense would tell us that they should be protected, handled with the same care with which bakers handle flour. Creative people are now condemned to serve and work in terms of finance success and the stock exchange, while communication concepts, ideas, and scenarios are conceived and decided on by specialists on communication and marketing managers. And by level upon level of manager who make sure that the result is banal and stupid enough to satisfy the public that they call the target. Just look at the advertising of telephone. I mean, I'm insulted. I'm a client too. I mean, they don't speak my language. What about you? No, just think what they show you all the time. Commercial success, not creativity, is what counts. Doing so, most of the image of media are stupid, flat, costly, repetitious, and useless. Communication is a means of delivering messages produced by an institution and corporate power that is polluting our life with a miserable level of culture and creativity. But not fair. The only thing that's missing is courage. The courage to take risk, and anyone who doesn't take risk cannot be creative. Now, here we come. Excitement about new technologies and every conceivable kind of software sustaining modern communication justify our creative inertia. So this is, you understand that. We are all becoming very, very much very lazy. We delegate to the machine what we should actually create. In the meantime, a huge part of inhabitants of this planet have never heard a telephone ringing. Less than 7% of the world is online. In other words, 93% of our world population does not have access to internet. What we refer to as technological and digital divide is an unbridgeable crack in the earth that acts more like a barrier, safeguarding and enriching those who have access and dividing them from those who have nothing. This year, 100 million children will be born. Today alone, another 230,000 individuals will come to this world. 97% of those children will be born in the third world. In 50 years, Europe's population will have shrunk by 25%. In 1900, Europe's population was 3 times larger than that in Africa. But in 2050, Africa's population will be 3 times larger than Europe, AIDS permitting. According to present rate of world wealth, 6% of humanity possess 59% of all wealth. And 50% would suffer from malnutrition. So this, the rich get richer and the poor get poorer. Today, communication with all its media is like some colas. With all the technology. Technology is like a colas. Coca-Cola, Pepsi-Cola, and so on, are largely content-free, artificially flowered, infinitely reproducible soft drink based on a memory of addiction. Pancha Vadikt, sweetening our false need, no potential for sustenance and nourishment, and no enduring quality beyond an immediate need of thirst. A thirst of what? An endless yearning to fill the space, that gaping hole left when we are not fed or truly satisfied or loved. As we cannot love ourselves, we create substitute love from the outside, and we mold medias and technology to perform that virtual role for us. And like using monosodium glutamate, the communication food tasted great, is addictive, but can leave you feeling bloated and tired with an headache. When you get up from your computer after 8 hours, don't you have an headache? I ask myself. Leaving a trace of addiction, and like addicts, we always return for more and more, our memory washed from the past, but not free enough to live the present or to imagine a better future. So most of communication look like most of product look alike. It is branded and conditioned by marketing that make us feel part of the herd, the vast global flock of livestock, where to be different means to be alienated. Branding means exactly that. A burning log of ownership stamped forever in our brain. Here it is one. No one wants to be a black or lost sheep. So we are low lamb of the slaughterhouses of communication, and especially that of the multinational brand. A brand is a membership card. It means that we belong to a global club in the race against mortality, a race against time that tries to stop death, which is snapping at our heels. Brand do not nourish society. Brand are nourished by society. Creativity in communication is anything but superficial. Increasingly, it nourishes our fear, augment our deepest feeling of insecurity. We are convinced that our future survival depends on what we consume, on material riches, and on power. The media has been sterilized. They are one way only, reproducing themselves in a monoculture, a fantastic version of excitement and promises, a place where Disney and sperm are deep frozen. To be revived in the future, of course, with technology, evolving in highly sophisticated software system, final solution that are influenced and amplified by the arm of intellectual property. Today, communication feed on the people that they should be fed instead. Originally, it was thought to be a public service. The voice of production and consumption, the voice of culture. But now it has degenerated, becoming an instrument of economic manipulation. Intellectual, creative people and artists who produce communication are in the first line of this army of collaborationists. Artists should have the power finally to free themselves from their fear. The future need is to allow the artists real power and responsibility in the world of communication. It's about time to revolutionize the situation. Creativity has to be subversive, and unless it encounters an intelligent patron or institution, it is destined to remain outside pre-established plan and bureaucratic authorization. We not produce creativity, but conformity, opting to publish cliché clone from a palette of prefabricated ideas. Everything must be capable of being reproduced. This is a problem of evolved society, democracy. Very rarely, political and economic power will assume the responsibility for experimenting, but prefer to stay on a beaten track. So, sì, bene, no? You want to again? Don't you like the clock? No, I can give you the thing again. Where were we? Venice? Wake up? Let's start from wake up. How can you sleep? So, we almost finished. We can hope to find creativity in young people who are taught to conform. Yet, without creativity, there would be nothing to spark enterprise. There would be no industry and therefore no economy. Communication with all these entire media could really be at the service of the humanity. They could be creative means of research into the new language that we are searching to symbolize, identify the human condition and the extension of society, to understand and explain the new world that is racing toward us with the speed of a meteorite. Communication that could be utilized to help to enrich humanity in the laborious task of expressing itself better in this world, to connect with the rest of society and permit a better future. This kind of media and communication could challenge and provoke debate about ideas. It could break the rules, destroy the preconception and the conformist that rule and condition us. This could give rise to true beauty and give us the opportunity to create in a condition of free expression, communicating true and profound beliefs to the world around us without being conditioned by the profit. We have the possibility to change the messages, rearrange the entire image. We must have the courage to risk being different. No one should be culturally, physically, or spiritually starved. Channels of distribution do exist. Creative people and providers and creators of content may have the key to unlock real communication. Communication and real meaning that could change our life and the life of others with creativity and respect. We need to create a dialogue, not a monobrand, a monothought, a monologue, a monoculture. We have to alter all messages, rearrange the world image. We should not only be survivor of a species, but we should prosper creatively and evolve dynamically. We must recognize the whole human race as a brand, with all its diversity, ethnic and colors, its differences and sometimes its limits and vetoes. A human brand based on respect, not on power, possibility, not uniformity, love, not fear. Creativity is a surplus of intelligence and sensitivity. It is the opportunity that potentially lies between our heart and our brain. Our spirit needs that kind of creativity in the modern communication. I think I finish here. And there are questions, there are... at the end we might...
Hola. Buenas. Habla de la creatividad para luchar contra...
Viene a tradurre.
Vale. Habla de la creatividad para poder reaccionar y de la comunicación para poder fomentar la creatividad. Nosotros cuando seguimos un patrón...
A ver, habla de la creatividad que decías. Habla de la creatividad.
Para para luchar, o sea, para reaccionar. Y la comunicación. Y la comunicación para fomentar la creatividad, para poder.
La comunicación es per fomentar la creatividad.
Ajá. Cuando nosotros seguimos el camino de una marca o de un estado, ¿somos víctimas o somos culpables?
Cuando andiamo per la strada di una marca,
¿somos víctimas o somos culpables?
¿Siamo víctimas o siamo colpevoli?
Ma dipende che coscienza ha lui. Io non mi sento colpevole.
No, por sí, la falta de creatividad.
Non ho capito forse la domanda. Chi è vittima colpevole?
Uno, quando... When you follow the path of brands, are you guilty or...
Quando non tienes creatividad.
No, ma non ho questo senso cattolico
sí,
del peccato.
Quando sigues el conformismo.
Che è il momento.
Okay, when you conform with the system, are you a victim or are you guilty?
Well, you can be both. I don't know what is conforming with the system.
O con una marca, o con un patrón, por ejemplo, lo que dice de seguir un camino, lo que nos venden y no usar la creatividad para ir y fomentar lo que tenemos que defender, valores.
When you conform to a brand or to a product and you don't...
No, il padrone. Abbiamo tutti un padrone. Anche Michelangelo aveva un padrone, cioè il Papa. L'arte, una volta la... what is it, in italiano? No, what speak English, ok? So, communication, art, has been always the service of a power, I told you. Once used to be religious, it is political, for sure, and it is industrial. We always have to deal with what I said, the market, but the market is not just what we first think when you say that word. It is what is there is that, what kind of humanity is there in front of your work. So you have to deal with that. I don't believe in the artist that isolates himself and he paints for himself. I don't take pictures for myself, I don't need.
Gracias.
Sí, en relación al último trabajo que está haciendo sobre retratar gente.
In relationship to the last work you're doing.
Sobre ese estudio móvil que lleva encima, retratar gente. A mí me recuerda un poco a los primitivos fotógrafos que iban de pueblo en pueblo retratando gente.
Exacto, como el primo fotógrafo, fantástico.
Sí. Quisiera preguntarle, porque si en la Campus Party ha encontrado en los tres campuseros inspiración para su trabajo de retratar gente, si ha retratado a alguien.
Se hai trovato ispirazione fra questi giovani che sono qui per fare quel tipo di ritratti in serie?
Sì, si potrebbe fare, ma devo dire che questa è un po' una monocultura, uguale in tutto il mondo. This is a monoculture, it's the same all over the world. Very interesting. Being connected like that, you lose your local, you know, your local spirit, let's say like that. I'm not against that, but we could be in Minnesota here. Same. So I never thought that Spanish people could look Norwegian. We could be Norway here, no? Is that good or bad? I don't know, it might be good. So, but that's how it is. You know, I have to say something. Yeah, you want to make a question? No, I thought you wanted to know. No, today I was speaking with my friend, he was taking me here. One of the campus party organizers, and say, yes, I see all that application to technology. Everybody is there fascinating by that. And I understand, me too, no, I like. But I'm not fool enough to let me fool by that. And I say, what is about what comes before technology in a human being?
What is about that part of your heart and brain and guts that make you think about an image or a project or something that you have to do before to decide what kind of technology I'm going to use to make it? Who is developing in you that part? Why there is not here in Campus Party such a thing? You can't say this is creativity. There is such a thing. You know, creativity booth there. I told you, creativity is not nothing. It's not a computer. Creativity is something else. Is a pencil more or less powerful than the biggest computer in the world? Can somebody answer? Is a pencil more or less powerful than a computer? So, that power, from where is coming? For sure not the pencil. So where is that part? Here. Yesterday I walk into that room, 1,000 people sitting there, silently. And they are all communicating silently, alone, isolated, sitting next to each other. And suddenly one gets crazy, screams. It's fantastic. No, a madhouse. Could make a movie right in there.
Hola. Me interesa mucho el debate acerca de la necesidad que usted plantea de que el arte y la creatividad sea siempre rompedora, rupturista con la realidad. Porque no creo que esto siempre sea así. Por ejemplo, no en el campo de la música, en el que el lenguaje social prácticamente es inexistente. No creo que Bach, por ejemplo, fuera un hombre que rompiera en su comunicación, que tuviera afanes rupturistas, ni mucho menos.
Can you translate? So, I vaguely.
Yes. He wanted to touch upon your previous comments of creativity has to break with
the rules, the barrier.
Okay, that it has to be basically a disruptive process, saying that he feels it doesn't apply necessarily to music, that he feels that Bach, for example, was not necessarily a disruptive artist.
Yes, but Bach or Mozart, Bach. No, okay. I said Mozart just to have, no, Bach. He is exactly the music, the image of his time, in the highest quality expression. Bach in 100 years, 500 years, 1,000 years, will still be Bach and modern. It's like Goya. There is such a thing as modern art or old art. All good art is modern. The modern art that we say now, modern art, in 50 years will be forgotten, unless somebody will be like Goya, and Goya will be still modern. The deposition of the Christ of Mantegna, I don't know if you know that painting, that, you know, the deposition of Christ, now you got all the computer going, look, Mantegna, deposizione del Cristo, okay? Look at that painting. I'm an atheist, I don't believe in God, in Christ, but such a painting does transcend religion, believing everything. So that is where the artist has to work. Transcend the request. Then he becomes an artist. Everybody has got the client that he deserves. If you got bad client, that means you're not so good.
Okay, he disagrees that there's a rupture in language or rupture in code.
But it's their social group too.
Okay, but not necessarily a social
group. You say there is no social, got nothing to do with social. That was, I think that any picture, any sound, any human expression has got to do with, is a social, political expression. Even Disney is. Even Mickey Mouse.
He'd like to ask you what your creative process is. How did you find inspiration for the pictures that you've taken?
Okay, this is a good idea. This is a good question, because, you know, I work with just young people. They have to be under 24 now. First job, I don't care if they went to school or nothing. Actually, sometimes it's much better if they didn't go to school. And of course, I select them all by instinct and by looking in the face. I don't care about portfolio, anything like that. And I choose the people. You know, there are a lot of young people that come and see me to work in my factory. And they say, ah, I'm creative. Already when they say I'm creative, I know it's fact. I'm creative, that's it. I got good idea. I got a lot of ideas. I could be very creative, but I don't know how to express them. I say, okay, that, you know why? You're not an artist, as simple as that. You are not an artist. A real artist doesn't have that problem. A real artist doesn't complain that he can't express himself. A real artist, what he does is to express himself, simply like that. If you got that problem, give up to be an artist. Because we all can think of 25,000 ideas in a minute. The problem, what are you able to do? What are you able to produce? Have you got the capacity? That is what is an artist. And personally, I haven't got ideas. And some people say, where do you get your idea? I don't get ideas. Then it doesn't mean that I'm a flat-minded and then suddenly I got an idea. What I do is what I am and what I think. As simple as that. I'm not trying to get an idea better than my brain. No, I don't need to do that. And nobody should do that. We have got two eyes, and nobody in the past, in the present, and in the future will look at the world of anything through our eyes. That point of view is just your forever. And so is your mind, is your brain, is your heart, is you. Nobody has been like you, nobody is like you, nobody will ever be like you. You are a piece of art. Believe that. You and you and you and you and you and you. Unique. Unicity. Not conformity.
This is a two-part question. If there's a balance between art and economy, or economics?
Art and economics?
Yes.
The relation?
Yeah, if art, if there's a, what the relation?
La relación entre arte y dinero?
No. Si hay equilibrio entre un artista que gana mucho dinero.
Say the question loud so everybody will listen to the question. Yeah, the other one would want to know what he's asking me.
Sí, yo pregunto si un artista puede dedicarse profesionalmente y ganando mucho dinero, o un verdadero artista es simplemente expresarse y ya está.
¿Puedes saber si un artista debe
ganar mucho dinero?
¿Ganar
mucho dinero?
Earn lots of money.
Rembrandt was very rich.
Of course, well, that is bad about making money.
No, yo pregunto si un artista puede.
A painting of Picasso, so expensive that few people can buy it. The economy is a result of a creativity, eh?
Y mi otra pregunta es si existe un verdadero arte o el arte subjetivo.
Si è una vera arte o I don't understand the question.
Whether there is a if art is constant or subjective, what's considered the quality
there
of art?
There is an artist?
No, if what is real art is a constant or if it's subjective to the viewer.
I think that there are expression that we produce, that there are the right expression for the right moment, okay? I said before, art is the highest quality of communication. Okay, we communicate all the time, but then suddenly, when you get to a certain level, it becomes art. And why is art? Because there is a need to see, to listen, to absorb that expression, that movie, that picture, that piece of music. So that in that moment, society needs. Sometimes it's not the whole society. It might be just a minority that is a little advanced within the society. So an artist is somebody who is doing that image at that moment, and that kind of images, or music, or movies, or painting in the past, of sculpture, or architecture, has been so right, so perfect, so incredible, that will stay modern. Gaudí, you can't say it's modern architecture, but it will stay modern forever. Incredible. And that was Gaudí, like that, and there was Neutra on the other side. Completely different, but both, they are modern. So no, it's not a question of form, but it's a question of knowing what the human condition, here we go back, at that moment is needed.
Yes. You said at the very beginning that to be a creator, that creativity is a result of done work. So if I follow your thoughts, you depend on
understand.
The...
No, say it again. I didn't understand.
Okay, you said at the beginning that creativity is a result of done work.
Yeah.
Es un resultado del trabajo, la creatividad.
Sí.
So you depend from the people around you to be a creator, a creative person, because you're, as you said, you're a creator just after people say that you are creative.
I don't know if the people here are creative. For sure there are creative people here. For sure there are people who potentially could do something very creative. Yeah. I'm very suspicious about letting yourself know go with technology. You know, it seemed like my colleague photographer that they have to have the latest model of camera to make the best picture. There are incredible pictures made in the past was made with primitive camera. So, you see, it's not the technology that is going to define the quality of the art. No, it's not. It's not the pen who is deciding the quality of the poetry. You can write with a Bic, and you can write with a Mont Blanc. The important is the poetry. Hi. So we let ourselves go with that incredible drug that is called technology, and we think that when we are take a drug, we are better artist. It's not true. I never saw somebody under the effect of drug being more creative.
Hi, I am over here. What advice, you've worked with clients all your life, what advice would you give to people, you know, creative people, to work around the bureaucrats of this world who try and, you know, stifle your ideas?
You know, it's very bad sound here. I don't know why, but it's double sound.
Do you want me to repeat?
Yes, please.
You have worked with clients all your life, and what advice would you give to creative people to work around the bureaucrats and people who try and make your work banal? What advice would you give?
You shouldn't be afraid to try. You shouldn't be afraid to go encounter criticism. You shouldn't be afraid in general. Who of you has been obliged to do the work you do? Please raise your hand. So you all belong to that little percentage of privileged people who did choose their job. Okay? It's true? Nobody is obliged. So you didn't have to go to the army or be a miner, you know, in the mine, or be a traffic thing, or do those jobs that you have to do because you have to make your bread. So you all belong to a privileged few who did choose what he's doing. So I got no pity for you. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Yes. Okay. And you might even want it to be an artist too. It's even more incredible, more privileged. So if you don't perform, please give up. Change.
Okay, I think we have time for one last question. Una última pregunta. ¿Habías preguntado? ¿Alguien más tiene alguna pregunta?
There is time, no, for a little film, no? You want to see a film?
Quería preguntar si podías definir en muy corto lo que es la creatividad.
I said it twice. La creatividad. Es un surplus de inteligencia e sensibilidad. Is the opportunity that potencialmente, giusto? Sta, lies, how do you say lies? Risiede, sta, se imbraga entre el corazón y la cervello. E questa è la creatività. Capito? Devo ripetere in arabo. Vuoi fare? Okay. No, there is. Ah, come fai? Aspetta. La technology zero. Come
vai
fai?
Qui sui view. No.
View?
Sì. Full screen. Là, no, quello. Kaboom. Adesso tecnico del sonido.
Il sonido.
Scatenando la radio, chiaro. Un passo dallo scontro per lanciare gli avversari.
Can we begin the video again?
Vediamo se lo sistema.
Mettiamola.
Yeah. Okay. Can we do one?
La bellezza della tragedia.
Paese dopo 18 anni di guerra sprofonda
they come.
Massacri, opera dei servizi segreti.
La libertà si continua a pagare con la vita.
Gli orrori della pulizia etnica nella ex Jugoslavia.
Yeah.